so much for this time that you've given us, and that we're able to still gather together and learn more about you, God, and fellowship with one another, encourage one another. And I just pray tonight as I go through this psalm that you just speak through me, this be your word and not mine. And we pray that whatever you want these kids to take away with and to learn from, allow that to be. And God, I just pray that as I speak, you know, as you speak through me, we just focus this time on you, God, and we just desire to know and learn more about you. And we love you, Jesus. In your son's name we pray. Amen. All right, can someone read for me Psalm 7? Paul. I didn't even say what Psalm. Johnny on the spot over here. All right, Psalm 70.
May all who seek you rejoice and be glad to you, in you. May those who love your salvation say evermore, God is great. But I am poor and needy. Hasten to me, God, O God. You are my help and my deliverer. O the Lord, do not delay.
Thank you. Good. So in this psalm, David recognizes his need to be delivered from his sin. He cries out to the Lord to deliver him from his sin, just like we are in need of a deliverer as well. Pretty sure we all sin, or we are sinners. So that's why Jesus Christ came to this earth to take our punishment for our sin. And as we see in this psalm, that David is seeking the Lord for deliverance. And so it's a really good reminder for us that we're in need of a Savior and deliverance as well from our sin. I want to break this psalm into two parts, so the first three verses and then the last two verses. So in the first three, David is talking and asking God to deliver him and to help him out of the situation that he's in. So does anyone know much about King David? Anyone know anything? I know, you know, he's probably king, right? Did everyone love him? No. Stephen, do you have something?
Lots of people wanted to kill him.
Yeah! Lots of people wanted to kill him. Great answer, and that's the one I'm talking about. Yeah, that's what I was getting at. So while he was writing this psalm, people researched and studied it. It seemed to be around this time he was writing it, somebody was indeed trying to kill him. And he wrote this psalm out of someone trying to kill him. Like, that's really... I would say that's a really hard time. He is asking for him to deliver him out of this particular situation. Like Stephen said, David had people who hated him, wanted to murder him. Even his own son was one of these people who wanted to murder him. And we think around this time that he wrote this psalm is when his son was trying to, Absalom was trying to murder him. I think it's kind of normal to ask God to change our circumstances from time to time, especially when someone's trying to murder you. I think I would. Like, just, I wouldn't say that. I think that's a pretty safe bet. If someone was trying to kill me, I'd probably not want it to happen and then want it to stop. And I'd probably pray that. And that's good. And that's fine. But in the last two verses, the next two verses 4 and 5, David focuses on rejoicing and being glad in the Lord, regardless of whether his circumstances change or not change. He's still praising the Lord, and he is exalting him and acknowledging that he is the Lord of salvation, that he provide salvation, and he's the only one that can deliver. So David was still going to praise God, even if his circumstances never changed. So sadly, like, over my life, I've known a lot of Christians that I know genuinely love the Lord, but I would see that sometimes they would get upset or bitter or angry at God when their circumstances wouldn't change. And there's some emotions with that. Like, we're going to be sad when our situations are hard and bad. But I've known of people who stopped believing in God because of their circumstances. They didn't like them. So I'm going to ask you guys, y'all know anywhere in the Bible where God promises that if we believe in him, that our life on earth will be perfect?
Never said that.
You're right, because I can't find it. Can you find it?
Nope.
Travis, you studied many years in seminary.
Sure.
Did you find it?
I'm not.
And not, why didn't you find it? Not in it.
It's not there.
It's not there. So you can keep searching and it's not in it.
I can't find it.
You can't find it. He looked. He searched the whole Bible just now. Paul did it. He couldn't find it. Does anyone know of anything, like a verse in scripture, something that God does promise us if we believe in him?
Eternal life.
Woo! Good job, Paul.
Thank you.
That's, is it good? Yes, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, whoever believes in him should not perish. And have everlasting life. Just so that's what we're promised. That's a pretty great promise, right? Eternal life. We get to be in perfect eternity in which we'll be praising God and we'll be in his holy presence forever. Sounds great to me. And so he promises that, and he doesn't promise a perfect world. In fact, he actually guarantees that we're going to have problems in this world. One verse that I learned when I was really young, and I memorized it, and it sticks with me, is John 16:33, which says, I have told you these things, so that in me, in God, you may find peace. In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I've overcome the world. God says that, and so he's like, you're going to have trouble. Don't worry, I got this. I overcame the world. I overcame sin and death. But you'll have trouble. So he knows, we know it. But he doesn't say, worry your life away because there's going to be trouble and hide under a tree your whole life because you're going to have trouble. He says, I have this. He we can find our peace in him. And that he's already overcome the world, so we can trust him with any circumstance that we have in this world and on this earth. So we'll still have hard times. But this verse shows us that our hope and peace is not in our circumstances, but it is in Christ alone. So it's like, we'll have trouble, but it's okay because we have Christ, and he has this. He's got it. Has anyone ever not liked the situation or circumstances they've been in some point in their life?
Probably.
Oh, yeah. Same. Me. Definitely. Both hands, both feet. Mm-hmm. Yep.
All limbs.
All in.
All fingers.
All fingers and toes. At some point we probably thought, like, man, if this could just change, I would just be happier, my life would be better. For example, like, there's been time, or maybe you've thought, and I think I've thought too at one point, if I just went to like a different school where I liked the other kids more, my life would be better. Or if I lived in a different neighborhood or in a different town, my life would be better. And then honestly, like, be real here. I'm gonna guess, I know I have in the last 5 months, with everything in the world going a little crazy, COVID, we're probably thinking, man, if this would just go away, everything would be better.
Oh, yes.
Maybe it would. And sometimes it's okay to ask God to change our circumstances. Sometimes we're also in circumstances that aren't great, and it's okay to change them. Sometimes we might be in a bad circumstance, And if we're allowed, if we're able and physically able to change it, that's fine. That's okay. But this passage of scripture is kind of pointing us outside of our circumstances. So instead of looking to our circumstances to change in order for us to have this joy, to have this peace, we're looking at the wrong thing. Like I said, don't get me wrong, it's okay. Like if you're in a really bad situation and you have a way out, like that's fine and that's good sometimes. But we still seek the Lord above that. Let me explain that right. So we do see David doing this in this passage. We also see in the Old Testament there are three men who feared God, and they also wanted God to change their circumstances. So I'm going to point out, we're going to talk about this story in the Old Testament to kind of remind us, yeah, it's okay. We can pray for our circumstances to change, but ultimately our hope is not in the circumstances, it's in the Lord and who He is. So I'm going to read from Daniel chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. In this passage, there was a decree written. The king Nebuchadnezzar had made a decree. He had a statue. And that any time the trumpet music sounded, that all the people of the kingdom would bow down to the statue of the king. It was like worshiping the king. And that still kind of happens in a lot of some parts of the world, and many parts of the world where there's a statue and people make some noises and they bow down. That's a thing. And that happened probably more often back then. So there were three Hebrew men. Does anyone know who I'm talking about?
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Yes, great pronunciation too. Good job. So they believed in God, the one true God, and they refused to bow down to any other thing, any other person, any other idol, anything other than the one true God. So verses 13 through 18 said, "Then Nebuchadnezzar, in furious rage, commanded that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought to him. So they brought these men before the king, and King Nebuchadnezzar Nebuchadnezzar answered and said to them, 'Is this true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my God or worship the golden image that I have set up? Now, if you are ready, when you hear the sound of the harp, the horn, the harp, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, harp, bagpipe, and all kinds of music, to fall down and worship the image that I have made, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning fiery furnace. And who is the God that will deliver you out of my hand?' Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, 'O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us out of this burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up.'" So King Nebuchadnezzar is kind of giving them a second chance. Like, he likes these people, they're well-behaved, they're smart. He's like, "I'm giving you a second chance here. I heard you weren't doing the thing that I commanded you to do, but will you do it? And then we'll just call it a day, you can live, everything's fine. If you don't, I'm gonna have to kill you." And so they said, "Okay, kill us. God will deliver us. But if he does that, we're still not gonna worship this image. We're not. We're gonna obey the one true God." So were they more, did they let their circumstances change, like who they were and what they did? No, they still, no matter what their circumstance was, that's not a great thing. That's not a fun, and being in a furnace, that's not them. Like, I would not pick that way to go if I had to pick. So they knew that was gonna happen, being burned. And they were like, okay, sure, if that's what you're gonna do, God's gonna deliver us, and not, we're still not gonna obey. Anyone know how this story turns out? Elliot.
They get thrown into the furnace, but then they come back out.
Okay. Yes, very good. They sure did. They were thrown into the fiery furnace. Yes. So they made the furnace 10 times hotter. I think the king was a little salty. He was a little mad about this not being worshipped. So they pumped it up 10 times higher, and the men,
the guards died from the heat, but
right.
they didn't.
I know, crazy, right? So like, here I am, let's say I'm the guard or whatever, and I'm throwing people in, they die. It was so hot. So you would think, oh man, they're not even in the fiery furnace. If they died from the heat, then obviously you throw someone in there, poof, right? Sounds horrible, but that's kind of what you would think and what would have happened. So, yeah, not only that, they were in the fire, they didn't die. They're just hanging out, chilling. And also there was a fourth person in there. So like the king and the people who didn't die were looking in and they're like, there's three people just walking around in this fire. There's another person, and this person was pre-incarnate Christ. If you have any questions about that, our very own Travis Brown wrote a paper on it. And I'm pretty sure, since Travis is really smart, he probably got an A++++.
Plus.
Is what my guess is. They probably just gave him extra pluses because it was probably so good. So if you have any questions on it, he is the man to ask.
Where do I read it?
Where do you read it?
I'll email it to you.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's going to be good. And you might want to pack a lunch to eat it. It's going to be, like, intense. And, like, have your coffee. It's going to be good.
I don't drink coffee.
I don't either, but
I like it. Because I don't drink it very often.
So also, their clothes weren't even singed. You would think, like, you're in a fire. Yeah, you'd come out, you know, they just walked out like it was no thing. Your clothes, that's a miracle. Like, yeah. So, a couple of things that to take away from this story is two things. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were still willing to obey and honor God and to worship him only, even though they have pretty bad circumstances. They were willing to do that whether God delivered them out of the furnace or not. They still put their life, their action of trusting in him. It wasn't just saying it. They were like, put action behind it. Okay, just throw us in the furnace. That's fine. That's action. And they did it with their life. And the second thing is that God was in the fire with them. He was physically with them, his son. So even though we can't physically see him now, those who are believers and accepted Christ, we have the Holy Spirit living inside of us. So he's always with us. We're going to go through hard times, yes, but he's always with us. So the second two verses, the first part of verse 4 says, may all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. What do these verses say about who we should be glad in, or what we should be glad in?
God.
Yeah. So David is speaking to God in this psalm and says, we should be glad in you, Lord. We should be glad in the Lord. Does he say to be glad in our circumstances? deliver you a paper. Well, he might to Paul through email, but he won't be out on the paper route. And so, yeah, he doesn't say any lie in your circumstances. Let's be real, David had some pretty rough circumstances. I'm not gonna lie, I'll be honest. I get sad and upset if someone doesn't like me, okay? It's out there, just putting it out there. I can't imagine, I literally cannot imagine what I, how I'd respond, or what I would do if I knew someone was trying to murder me. Kind of a big deal. I mean, that's hard. Like, I would take it personally, especially if it was my child. Like, I don't think I'd be doing too good. And he was running. He was chasing. I mean, he was being chased. And it was no joke, too. I actually got to go to Israel several years ago, and I was in the spot where David was hiding from King Saul. Guys, it's legit. It's like scary. There was one part you're just like, I thought I was gonna die. You're gonna like fall to your death. So I turned around, and I wasn't gonna climb because I was too scared. It was legit. And so like, it's not just a nice, luscious cave that he hid in. I mean, I was scared. I mean, I'm sure it's changed since hundreds of years ago, but it was like a scary place where he was hiding from him. Like scary, I mean like dangerous. I thought I was gonna roll off the cliff. But I didn't, because I turned around, I was a scared pants. So that's real. Like if someone was chasing after me, I just can't even imagine. And I know I'd probably be begging and asking God to change this situation, and I think that's normal and fine. But then David, he does ask for that, but then he goes on to rejoice in the Lord. He talks about the Lord's salvation. He says, God is great. He's being chased to be murdered, and he praises God. He acknowledges his goodness and his greatness. And just a reminder, people are trying to kill him, and yet he still praises God. Why do you think one should praise God? Because I got an A on my test? Because I ordered one donut and they gave me two donuts? It's pretty cool. But I mean, like, is that, do I only like, or let's say my grandma was sick and now she's better. Those are great things and we should be thankful and thank God for them. But he's worthy of our praise even if any of those things don't happen. So regardless of any of our circumstances, God is always sovereign. He's always righteous, always just, always holy, always great. He's powerful enough to where he spoke this world into existence. He formed humans from dust. Like, he's all powerful. None of that changes. All those things, God is great, he's holy, he's righteous, so many more things. They don't change when my circumstances do. And in scripture it says, God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If not, he's different when Sarah is sad and she doesn't like her circumstances. No, he's the same. Always. He's all those attributes. Even if trouble on this earth is happening. And so, several years ago, I had very hard circumstances in my life. And there was one situation, it was very impactful and it was very, very hard. And one of the hardest things I had to go through, especially at that time. And I was very sad. I didn't like my circumstances at all. Very hard. And during that time, the Lord really drew me closer to him. I was already a believer, but I had a lot of time in my hands to read God's word and to really understand what it's like to live for the Lord and not to say I live for the Lord, but my actions to live for the Lord and put him above everything else. And what it actually looked like versus should do. But God taught me so much during this time. And one of the things he taught me, I was reading the book, the Good Christian Book, and this was a while ago, and I just remember this story so much. It really stood out to me. And there was a Christian author, it was another author just telling me about this story with Max Lucado. I don't know if anyone's heard of him. He's a famous Christian author. Anyway, so the story is talking about how one day this author, his daughter almost drowned. That's scary and terrifying. Like, your life flashes before your eyes. I can't imagine. I have little nieces. Like, I'd slip out if I thought something like that was happening to them. But she didn't drown. She was fine. And so later that day, Max, the author, is writing in his journal. He's like, God, I praise you that my daughter didn't die. I just praise you. And then he stopped and he was like, what if my daughter had died? Would I not still praise God? And so that really helped me kind of separate my circumstances. It can be sad, it can be horrible, and how God is still worthy of my praise. He is all those things. He doesn't change. He's still worthy of my praise, even if something horrible, like my child was drowned. And so, another thing I realized, I grew up in a Christian school. I don't know if some of you guys have, like, Christian co-ops or homeschool or whatever, or grew up in church, too. So I remember, I think, every single day of my life, we opened the day in prayer, and the teacher would always say, are there any prayer requests? And people would say, oh, my grandma's sick, my dog, you know, whatever, they gave prayer requests, and those were good. And then she would say, are there any praise reports? Which is fine. And so kids would raise their hand and like, oh, my grandma was sick, but now she's better. Praise God. And we all go, praise God. It was a praise report, which is fine. And the teachers, all 100 of them over my kindergarten through high school, they all meant well. It wasn't like they were like, don't praise God when your grandma is sick or dies. Like, they weren't saying that. It just subconsciously trained my brain, and I thought kind of train other people's brains, like other Christians, especially like seeing them as adults. Their tendency just goes to, when something good happens, I praise God. And then kind of like forgetting to praise God when something bad happens. And I get that you're going to be sad and devastated, but it's so vital to understand that He's still worthy of our praise. Like, His righteousness, Him being just and holy, does not change when someone on this earth that I love passes away or something really bad happens. And so, that, all those things really just helped me get to the place to understand, no matter what happens on this earth, God is worthy of our praise. And I said a lot. Kind of just as Travis mentioned a moment ago, my dad is really sick. He's really sick. So 10 years ago, he was diagnosed with a disease called ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease. It's where, my brain, when it thinks, up there, raise your arm, I can raise my arm. Well, his neurons can't do that anymore. So it kind of slowly progressed. But his mind is still there, and he can still talk a little bit, but he can't move any other part of his body. And 5 years ago, he would have died if he didn't get on this really big, he didn't have this really big surgery. Now he breathes through a cord, and it's hooked up to a machine, and he just prays to God still. But he's very high risk, and that's why I'll be wearing this mask. He can't scratch his nose. Me and my family, we are professional nose scratchers, eyebrow scratchers, ear scratchers. We know how to scratch because he gets itches and he can't scratch it. You know, he can't move anything. And so, plus a lot of other things he can't do. He can't eat anymore. That's kind of sad. I'd cry if I couldn't eat like brownies anymore. That would just be a sad day for me. But he handles it. It's fine. And he doesn't like it all the time. Trust But he still glorifies and praises God. Because praising God and glorifying and exalting him doesn't have anything to do with our circumstances. And that's where we see in this psalm, David 2. People are trying to kill him. Not fun. That's no good. He's still praising God. And so, back to, I think we talked about this last week. What is the chief end of man? Catechism.
Glorify God and enjoy
Him
forever.
Glorify God, thank you. All in Stephen. Glorify God and enjoy Him forever. We have one job. What is your one job? Paul.
Glorify God and enjoy Him forever.
And there's other things. You know, I mean, we're supposed to love one another. Like, out of that comes a lot more. But our reason why we're on this earth is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. And my dad is still able to do that. Even though he can't move, can't eat, he can't breathe on his own, but he still praises God. So, wrapping this up and main conclusion, even though it's okay sometimes to not like our circumstances, and like I said, there's some times where it's a really good thing to change your circumstances. Like, if you're in a bad one, it's probably a good thing. Like, maybe get help from someone, figure out how you can get out of a bad situation. There are definitely times like that, and that's not what I'm saying. And the point of that, but it's to rely, to not rely on our circumstances. It's not to want to just change and so we'll be happy. Sometimes there's safety involved, but not to rely on our circumstances for happiness or joy, but just like King David did, to rely on the Lord and our focus be on Him, our minds be in a mindset of always praising Him, no matter what happens to us on this earth. Now we will pray again. Dear Heavenly Father, again we just come before You. I praise You for who You are. We thank You that You sent Your one and only Son to die for us, to take the punishment of our sin. We deserve separation from You, God. We deserve eternal hell. But God, You sent Your Son in our place so that we can have eternal life for You, God, with You. And that is so much better than anything on this earth. God, I pray that when we have our circumstances on this earth, that it will just point us to You, that we'll just long for You, long for eternity, long for when we are in Your presence and we just praise You all the time. God, I just pray we long for that. And we do have this uncertain circumstances right now, God, but You are certain. So just let us and allow us to have our hope fully in You, and not what's going on in our lives on this earth. God, we just love You. We praise You. Just God, remind us all day long that You are worthy of our praise no matter what happens. We love You. And Jesus, we ask these things in Your Son's name. Amen.